We begin this evening with what was to be a long conversation with Senator Edward Kennedy. He has served in the Senate for more than 40 years. People on both sides of the aisles will tell you that he is one of our great senators. He has a remarkable legislative history. He knows and loves the Senate as an institution. He is part of the institution, and he understands what makes it work, that it requires reaching across to people on both sides of the aisle. We didn't get to do that interview today because of interruptions. We look forward to having another conversation with Senator Kennedy at another date. Here is a part of what we did today. Senator Edward Kennedy in conversation at his office in Washington. Do you think where you are on important issues of our day is where the country is, or where you'd like to see the country be?
Where I'd like to see the country be. I believe that the individuals and the nation does best when it's challenged. I think this country has demonstrated it over its history. I mean, look how this nation came out of the Depression. Look how we've responded in terms of World War II. Look how we've even finally, when we were confronted the issues of segregation by Dr. King and really facing us, even though we'd written slavery into the Constitution and we'd had a civil war. Finally, when Dr. King confronted us, we responded. We've made important progress in knocking down walls of discrimination. This country's always done well when it's been challenged. I don't feel that it's being challenged. You can't have the tax cuts we've had and be still involved in wars on this and asking a small group of people to take the burden and everybody else enjoy themselves. I think we have to understand now that we're facing a very different challenge, and that is the issue of globalization. And we're either going to get run out of town with the rush towards lower wages and outsourcing, or we're going to embrace it and say we are going to equip every citizen in this nation with the ability to be able to deal with the problems of globalization, and in that way ensure we're going to have the strongest economy in the next 20 and 30 years, and we will have a national security that'll be second to none. And we, I think, are pretty much dead in the water. The administration's policies are catching up with them. That's another issue. But I think, just generally speaking, this country does best, individuals do best, and we welcome these challenges. Americans like this, but we're not, that's not part of the whole political discussion at this time, and I think it's both, I think that's where we ought to be as a political party and where we ought to be as individuals.
And it's a role for the leaders of the party to step
and
forward and say, this is where we ought to be. We ought to be challenging America to do better.
That's it. It's not really, that doesn't even have to be a Democratic. It's where Americans would be. And I think intuitively and instinctively, people welcome that. They want to be involved. They this great sense of pride that we see reflected in the personal courage of the Americans who are serving in Iraq, what we saw on 9/11, the extraordinary bravery and courage of individuals. We used to talk about the greatest generation, we still do. That kind of, those kinds of efforts that we saw from people, you know, I don't like to use the word average people, but working families, working people, the personal kind of courage of those men and women, that's out there. People are proud of this country, and they welcome, would welcome it, and that's what we're missing.
Do you then believe that those Republicans like George Bush and Karl Rove and others who say we are beginning decades of Republican dominance, you look at the House, look at the Senate, look at the presidential election, are simply wrong? It is because Democrats haven't articulated a vision for the future that has...
Well, it's part the second, and I think we ought to welcome the Republicans want to talk about values. We'll talk about them. What about the value of work and the giveaways to the wealthiest individuals versus the failure to increase the minimum wage?
So minimum wage and tax cuts and all of that.
What about just sort of truthfulness on single source contracts to Halliburton and not providing body armor to American servicemen in Iraq? I think the whole issues in terms of what's happening to our cities and poverty are moral issues. We could talk about that. But I think beyond that, we need to look at what the central challenge is for us as individuals and for our country. And I think most of us understand, and the great philosophers pointed out, I mean, the great struggle between good and evil, I mean, between challenge and response. Toynbee coined it. It's right. The world is challenge and response. And this country has always done better in terms of challenge. And what we're just doing now is just sort of responding to the tides that are coming our way. And I think that it's not what this country really is about. Final point. You know, the Democratic Party is willing to take on very tough issues. We took on the tough issues, as we should have, in terms of desegregation. But as a result of that, as we know, it was a changed party situation in the South. The solid South that was Democratic has shifted and changed. Democrats took on the environment. That was a division between the environmentalists and workers, two core constituencies. But because we did, that has changed. We took on the issues of war and peace over a period of time, and that's divided the country. And because of that, we have paid for it in terms of the politics of the time. So, a lot of the difficulties and I still have not heard the Republicans from wanting to repeal the Medicare or repeal Social Security or repeal what we have done in terms of higher education, which were basically the efforts that were made by Democrats. But we paid a political price for that, and rather than retreating from it, we ought to understand that that's really a stamp of pride. And but so we ought to be looking for the future now.
What ought to be the debate about Iraq at this time?
Well, I think it's the debate ought to be really how, with the extraordinary success of the elections, which gives the Iraqis the opportunity. For them to say, this is our country, which is, it's not an extension of the United States. We're not going to have the United States calling all the shots, setting up the times, the dates, the Constitution and all the rest, but we are going to do it. And that was enormously important. Now they need the training. They need the training to be able to defend their own country. My own belief is so much of the insurgency is a reflection that the Iraqis feel that our presence there is part of an occupation, not a liberation. And that's explained in a host of different kind of ways, because we never had a plan. We had a plan to win the war but not win the peace. And there's been blunder after blunder after blunder in which we have participated. But in the basic back of the mind of the Iraqis is that here is this all-powerful nation that can go to the moon and back and win this conflict. Yeah. Many miles away in 3 days, and they can't provide electricity, they can't get the sewage out, they can't provide jobs, they can't provide the restoration or the rebuilding of Fallujah. Why don't they do this? Why can't they do this? And I think there's a growing sense that we are a part of the occupation. My sense is, with the General Abizay testifying before the Armed Services Committee, which I remember just last week, said they're getting 2,500 Iraqis a day that want to join the new Iraqi army. That's enormously encouraging. We know how to train the best army in the world. My wife has a nephew, 12 weeks of training. He had a couple of weeks off, went up to Fort Lewis, got his gear, was supposed to have a month in Kuwait, didn't, and is sitting on the back of a striker as the heavy machine gunner.
In Iraq. In 12 weeks of training, he was prepared to fight.
Prepared to fight, and the best in the world. And the best in the world, yeah. Mind you. And I was just in Massachusetts a couple of days ago and met Joe McDermott, United States Marine Corps, that had 8 weeks of Paris Island, boot camp, 4 weeks at Quantico, 20 days home, went out to Pendleton, had 2 weeks out there in the Vietnam War, flew in a continental plane to Saigon, and 30 hours later was getting shot at by the Viet Cong. We had the best. The Marines were the best.
So one of the debates ought to be, why aren't we training the Iraqis faster?
Let them do it. Give them 8 months. Give them 12 months. Give them 15 months. But let the Iraqis now defend their own country. Let's let them demonstrate, as they have at the polls, as at the voting, that this is their country. They ought to be willing to defend it. And with that, the United States can see as a goal the phasing out of American military presence and bring them home with honor.
With an exit strategy, would you suggest 15 months or 2 years or 1 year?
I would say by the end of 2006, we ought to set it as a goal. That is the goal to be set. Now that gives them all the way through the remainder of this year. Gives them 22 months.
So they got time to train the Iraqi soldiers, and they've got time to know that America doesn't have a long-term
wonder. The Iraqis wonder why we're building all these military bases in Iraq. Iraqis wonder why we are going to have the largest embassy in the world, in Iraq, larger than our embassy in China, larger than our embassy in India, and we're also building it in one of Saddam's old palaces. They have to wonder on this, and they sort of wonder what's does the United States now, with its energy consumption, really want to give us back our oil over there?
But let me ask the question. Do you have any question as to whether this administration wants to stay in Iraq, this administration wants to somehow have some kind of dominance over Iraqi oil?
I think there are people within the administration that are close to policymakers that that have that view.
But in the end, it's a president's decision.
Yeah, that's right. I don't see the indications at the present time. Although there is no exit strategy at the present time. We listened to Secretary Rumsfeld last week. He asked repeatedly.
Sure.
It's all open-ended. Yeah. I listened at the on the Armed Services Committee last week in the Armed Services Committee with Paul Wolfowitz. It's all open-ended. There is no end to this.
Tell you when we might be able to leave.
It's all left in when they're prepared to take on their responsibility, and not a day longer. Well, the Iraqis ought to be prepared to defend their own country. Americans are dying for it. Americans are paying for it. We're now up to $280 billion or more that we have spent on Iraq. We're paying treasure and paying in blood. We've lost 32 boys in Massachusetts.
But in a famous speech, you basically said the administration's reasons for going to war was a fraud. You said that. Do you believe now that their reasons for staying in Iraq is a fraud?
I think they're misguided. I think they're making it up every day. I don't think they have a plan. I don't think they have a program.
To get out.
The idea we went to Iraq was weapons of mass destruction, and because Iraq was tied with al-Qaeda on 9/11. Those are the reasons. That's in the resolution that was before the United States. Today, we're over there for democracy. We say there's no weapons of mass destruction. The 9/11 Commission says there's no al-Qaeda contact. We're over there now to establish democracy, and we can't quite know what the democracy is going to look like. We don't know whether there's going to be minority rights and whether the Shia are going to deal with the
Sunni. Do you believe...
all of this, and this is all open-ended now. If we had just had the vote in the United States Senate that we're just going over now and change the regime
and create a democracy
from Sunni to Shia, that wouldn't have gotten 10 votes in the United States Senate.
And so the end result of why they went to war in terms of explanation today would have had no chance in the Senate.
Absolutely none.
When they went to war.
Absolutely, absolutely none. The point is, it's even worse than that, because we've given up the pursuit of al-Qaeda. And we have
pursued
effectively with Osama bin Laden. We have a homeland defense, and we have security that's out there in Afghanistan, and we're certainly, if they're probably as many as 1,000 foreign fighters in Iraq, although the great numbers, the Iraqi intelligence estimate there's 30,000 to 40,000 Iraqis that are involved in the insurgency, 1,000 outsiders. The point is, the al-Qaeda now has moved into 100 different locations with all kinds of local chiefs. We had them on the run. We had them focused. They were in the crosshairs of the United States, and we gave that up. And now they're out there. So you say, well, you mean we wouldn't have gone to war? That's right. But we would have gone after al-Qaeda and after Osama bin Laden, and we would be more secure today.
Tom Friedman, writing in today's New York Times, as you may have seen, said that a decent outcome in Iraq is essential to the war against terrorism, and also would send a message to Iran in terms of seeing that a democracy could work, and would give encouragement to democratic forces in Iran.
And the best way to get that is the way that I've outlined, and that is to train the Iraqis and have the Iraqis defend their own country and be prepared to fight for it and die for it and work their way through a process towards a democratic institutions. That's exactly the way to go. And the way to achieve what Mr. Friedman says is the best way, is the way that I've outlined, not the open-ended continuation of what is perceived by the Iraqis as occupation.
Let me move to some Iran. What should the administration be doing in terms of affecting Iran and a decision not to go forward with a nuclear weapon?
Well, you know, when administration was talking about a country with weapons of mass destruction and also supporting terrorism, many of us thought they were talking about Iran.
Yes.
Because there was clear, at the time of the beginning of the Iraqi war, that this is where Iran was going, and they've been a notorious supporter for terrorist groups, and still are. There's obviously the efforts, there's been a consolidation, I believe, of leadership in Iran over the period of the last months. And the whole kind of question, I think, the dialogue that's taking place even within the Iranian leadership is how far to go in terms of engaging the West. And also, they are understanding that the United States went to war with Iraq that didn't have nuclear weapons, but didn't go to war with North Korea that did. And the arguments that are being made, obviously, to the Iraqis is that the best way to keep the Americans out of here is develop nuclear weapons, because the United States doesn't go to war with countries with nuclear weapons. Now, there's no question that there's real negotiations that are taking place with the Europeans. And there's no question that Iran's economic future is closely tied in terms of developing the relationships with Western Europe. We ought, I believe, be a part of those kinds of negotiations.
Do you have some belief that in the second term and Condoleezza Rice's trip to Europe and to the Middle East, that the president is now more open to multilateral solutions and an engagement of other countries rather than a unilateral approach that was championed in the first term?
Well, I would hope that is the case. And if I listened to Condi Rice during the course of her trip, I could hear those echoes, and yeah. I want it to be the case. And so I let myself believe that she certainly sort of understands that, and she is an influential person. That's certainly the hope. I think that that's a key in terms of our success, both in Iran and also with North Korea. I mean, there's clearly we have common interests in this situation with the Chinese. The Chinese have enormous kinds of influence in North Korea for a variety of different kinds of economic reasons and other reasons, security kinds of reasons. We ought to, the idea of us going it alone, we should have learned that. I think we have. And we have to understand that trying to work with other nations which have common interests, that it makes a great deal more sense. And I think hopefully that will be something that the administration has learned.
The president seems to believe that Social Security is the most important domestic issue facing the nation. Do you share that?
Well, it's the long-term interest in Social Security is a problem. The short-term, up to 2048, not so, according to the trustees. The interesting thing, if the president thought it was such a problem, why is he spending the $300 billion that he's taking in Social Security over the period of the next 10 years? Why is he using that in terms of his budget? Why isn't he setting that aside? I mean, hello? the fact remains, we 1977, 1983, the Congress came together when the Social Security was at much greater risk, and we took steps to secure it for 60 or 65 years. That same kind of willingness to do that is there today. I've seen it. They passed those particular provisions, passed by over 90 votes. Democrats and Republicans came together. But what they don't see now, they see the president identifying this as a crisis and then offering the private savings account, which really doesn't have anything to do with securing the economic stability of Social Security.
And it's not a budget item either, the transition cost.
It was never included,
right,
as the Iraqi were never included in the budget. Costs of the Iraq war wasn't included. Social Security transition costs have not been included. Making the permanent, the Bush tax cuts permanent, have not been included. And then making the adjustment on the tax, what they call the ATM, the alternative minimum tax, which today it was initially passed to just take care of those at the higher end of tax bracket that were escaping through all kinds of loopholes. Now that's really working out to the middle-income people. That has to be adjusted. You put those together, and you're talking about a country that is just swamped in red ink, and is basically now being bought up by the Asian countries, by the Chinese and the Japanese and the Koreans. And if they are not going to show up to buy these bonds, as they failed to show up about three weeks ago,
they have an economic
crisis. Or if the oil-producing countries decide to convert to the euro, you're going to have an enormous economic crisis. Now, they don't believe that that's going to be the case, because the one of the last bills that we passed to make some adjustment in terms of some tariff adjustments is going to be able to repatriate over $1 trillion, you know, from Western Europe and other parts of the country at very low rates now. And the administration basically thinks that's going to keep them afloat over the period of these next several years. This is all a gambling with the American economy. I mean, this is very, very important. It's the key, American economy. If the economy's bad, nothing else is right. And I think we've got very, very serious problems.
This is a place that you have spent more than 40 years. To read what they say about you is remarkable. Many people on both sides of the aisle believe that your contribution to the country from this service in the Senate, and they can tick off legislation and everything else, you know, is as great as if you had run for president and had two terms in the presidency. Tell me how you feel about this place and about being a senator and the legacy that you are building.
Well, it's first of all, it's an enormous honor. I mean, it's the greatest public honor you could possibly have. And I realize that and appreciate the kind of trust that the people of Massachusetts have given to me to be able to represent them in the Senate. And we've tried to, I've always perceived my role as to try to get some things done. It's been frustrating in the one sense as someone that's passionate about national health insurance, and have been fighting for that over 30 years, and we see these every single day, the human tragedies of human families that have been unable to do it.
What's
interesting, but we've made some progress over it, and I always feel that as long as I can keep making some progress, that and the people will keep me, it's wonderful to serve.
And you'll run for re-election.
I expect so. Will you let me make an announcement on your
yes,
show?
Yes, I will indeed.
I mean, Arnold does it. Leno,
why not you? Choose me.
There you go.
I think it's an appropriate choice for you.
Senator Abraham Kennedy today, as he approaches on February 22nd, his 73rd birthday. He is passionate about the issues that he believes in. He is respected on both sides of the aisle for a remarkable service in the Senate and a legislative record of accomplishment. We want to talk to him about a lot of things. Unfortunately, our time was cut short today, and we look forward to seeing him at a soon opportunity to talk about his principles, his vision for America, and how it fits into the American political spectrum. Senator Kennedy, in the weeks and months to come. We lost a good friend of this broadcast in a week or so ago. His name was Ossie Davis. He died in Miami Beach. He was 87 years old, best known as an actor with a deep voice who helped break the color barrier on Broadway. His 56-year marriage to actress Ruby Dee was one of the most honored and respected in the American film and theater world. Together, they came to this show to talk about their friends in the civil rights movement, their view of civil rights, their view of the theater, and what they loved most, which was acting and talking about this experience and life that they had as citizens of this country and as members of the theater and film community. Ossie Davis and Ruby Dee came here a number of times. You will see first a conversation that took place in 1998, a conversation which they talked about their life and growing up together as man and wife in the world of theater. Here is the first part of remembering Ossie Davis. Ossie Davis and Ruby Dee first met in 1945 when they both starred in the Broadway production of Jeb. The play closed after 9 weeks, but it spawned a partnership and a marriage that has lasted half a century, more than 50 years. Their prolific careers have intersected to create many memorable moments in theater as well as on film. These include A Raisin in the Sun in 1959, Pearly Victorious in 1961, Do the Right Thing in 1989. Their devotion to their craft and each other is joined by a lifetime commitment to civil rights and social justice. They talk about this and many other things in their latest joint project with Ossie and Ruby. It is a memoir of a remarkable journey in their life together, and I am pleased to have them back at this table. Welcome back.
Thank you so much.
Now look at this. Go ahead.
We just enjoyed seeing you, watching you through the years.
Thank you. It's like old home week.
It is. All right. It is time.
Okay.
Let me look at this. This is the amazing thing about the two of you. Now here is what, year 19 what?
This is 1946. We hadn't married then. Yeah. We were in a play together.
You got that look in your eye.
Yeah. And you can tell the sucker's hooked.
And he is hooked big time.
That was a scene from Jeb.
That's from Jeb.
That's
1946.
Mm-hmm.
You turn this around and this is 1996, 90, maybe? 1997, 1998?
Yeah.
1997.
Mm-hmm.
So we're talking about 50 years.
Yes, there to there. That's
right.
It's 50 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's incredible. I can't believe that 50 years has gone by. But then that's the nature of existence, you know?
Yeah, it is. Time passes.
Yes.
Was this an easy thing to do, or was it a hard thing to do? To put it all down on paper, both the good and the bad, the tough and the easy.
Let's say it was difficult coming down on both sides of the coin. It got easier as we got involved. Yeah. I had difficulty being convinced that it was
a good idea.
Good idea in the first place. So,
why?
Well, of the making of books, there is no end. I mean, Ecclesiastes said that, and it's gotten worse ever since he said it. So I wondered, why should I pile one more book on the pile of books that mankind hadn't gotten around to reading yet? Why mine? Ruby had a different answer.
What did you say when he said that?
Because I was terribly disappointed. It had been several offers that he turned down.
So what'd you do then?
I got me a little 2x4 like this. While he was asleep one night, I said, well, you're going to write this book. And he got the message.
Son of a woman, I'm married.
So that's about what happened?
Exactly.
He woke up one morning and said, you're right, darling. I am going to be writing the book.
Yes.
And then you made the decision. How did it go after you began to put pen to paper? Did you see everything the same?
There are points even in the book where we disagree. So I write my version, she writes her version, and we leave it to posterity to make the decision.
I can imagine how incredibly widely differing some of the passages are.
But there never seemed any value or virtue in agreeing on the details of our lives. I look back and I saw a fascinating story, which I like to break into bits and tell to the grandchildren. And that satisfied me. And Ruby looked back and saw something different. I don't care.
Yeah, I saw something about women and living and how hard marriage is, you know, and what's hard about marriage? Oh, God. When the hormones pop, you know, you think it's all going to be easy and you fall in love. But really, you have no idea what love is. It takes years for that to sink in, you know, particularly for a woman. With marriage, a woman's responsibilities are doubled. A man drops half of his, you understand? It takes my life and your life
I'm doing this on behalf of you. How do you see the difference in men and women? In their attitude, the way they live life, the way they approach life?
Women have a greater sensitivity to all the issues in life, you know, and they come to responsibilities, they come to nurturing and caring, they come to building, they come to taming a man, you know, understand what I mean? There's a little bit to that.
You got to tame the man.
I don't know if you call it taming, but there's something. My observation is that if you have a good man, you're very lucky, because then you have some good material with which to work.
You did pretty well on that, didn't you?
But
men come to realization because it's a man's world, it really is. Yeah. And men make the judgment calls, and they sometimes not fairly. They haven't looked at it from all sides. They come at life from a male perspective. And we have to work our way into the consciousness. When it works, it's marvelous. And when you talk about love, love is an aspiration, you know.
Something to aspire to.
Why
do you think it's worked thing in for the world. You guys, Ossie?
One of the reasons I think it's worked is because we are children of struggle. By that I mean we were born into a siege situation where our community was attacked and under duress and being oppressed, and everybody had to turn a hand in that struggle. There was no way not to be black. You couldn't escape that, and you had to respond to it one way or the other. So I grew up in Waycross, you know, where we had our problems and people trying to vote and great difficulty. Daddy, an active man, mom, an active man, all the teachers and everybody, we were engaged in trying to make a better life for ourselves. Teachers looking you straight in the eye and say, boy, your spelling grade, you know, is of account about what people think about your race. You have the option to fail. Everything you did was a part of the struggle. And then when I met Ruby, I found out that she too had come from a struggle background. When we married, Broadway was an arena where the struggle was being fought out, you know, just back from World War II. Black soldiers trying to vote were being killed. Isaac Woodard in North Carolina having his eyes gouged out. Broadway being involved in it, the NAACP, the Urban League, you know, all of us, we struggled. And the struggle is something that takes all of your time and all of your energy. It doesn't really care whether you're happy or not. There's something to be done, a rally.
There's something larger than your own.
Exactly. So we never had time to sit down and ask if we were happy. And I think that's good, not only for marriage. I think it's good for the human spirit and the human soul. And one of the reasons I'm glad that I did agree to write the book, it's because only on looking back and having to really ask myself what really held this thing together, that I come to appreciate that aspect of what helps knit people together.
Apart from theater and film and the creative arts, for both of you, the defining event of your life has been the Civil Rights Movement?
I would say yes.
Yeah.
The defining event of my life was being raised in Harlem.
Really?
Yes.
Shaped by the black cultural experience.
Yes, but I wasn't even thinking about the cultural so much as just the total life experience there, and the people that I met, and my mother, my stepmother, how that all came to be, and that was the defining. I came out of Harlem, and in that I try to put in perspective why. It has a claim on you, that place. It did then, I suppose it still does. The rhythm of the people and the sounds and the ideas and the everything was at a crossroads there. Prejudice and discrimination, as well as love and freedom and fun. And it was, I wasn't aware that I lived in a ghetto or anything like that.
Do you miss living there now? Or do you get back enough so that...
We get back there a lot, and we still have lots of friends there, and our son, a guy, and his wife, Dorothy, have bought a house in Harlem.
Lots of people are buying houses and restoring them and trying to create new Harlem.
A new Harlem. There's something special. It was like a crossroads place, you know.
Go ahead.
Could I chime in on what that defining moment for me and why I said civil rights? Civil rights really is a new way of expressing something that we used to describe quite differently. We were looking for freedom. We were looking for dignity. And when my high school years were over, 1935, you know, Mussolini was evicting Haile Selassie from Ethiopia. And, you know, we were agitated as people about that. I remember as a boy, friend of mine, you know, we wanted to go and join the Ethiopian army, but nobody knew which way Ethiopia was. We never quite made it. So it was these things that excited I felt the need to do something about it, to be involved in that. And when I left home and went to college, you know, the dormitories were full of debate between all the students and whatnot. And these issues were constantly brought to our attention. And Washington, D.C. was a place where there was a lot of segregation. And all the students were against it. And there was debates for and pro and con. And me, a little boy, watching and seeing these people, professors caught up in it, poets caught up in it. You know, it was to be free then was the way we described it. Mm-hmm. It was only after 1954, Supreme Court decision, we began to focus in on civil rights as the vehicle for all of this. Yes. But the things that excited me, the things that lit up my life, you know, was some response to the struggle for freedom and how it struck me and struck all the people around me.
The passion for freedom and justice.
Yes.
And it was like that. I was thinking the same thing. I don't remember the time when there wasn't some parade, something exciting coming up and down 7th Avenue and the street corner orators and the booksellers. And I mean, it had that kind of excitement. There were issues in the air since I could remember.
I want to come back to some of the civil rights struggle and the people you have known, but tell me why you became an actress.
I think that I was born with this capacity or desire to express. And thank goodness my mother recognized that. And if you're lucky, as a kid, somebody, a mother, a teacher, somebody will recognize that particular thing, you know. Yeah. This kid's going to be an architect. And my mother knew that I liked to express and recite. And she herself had wanted to be an actor. And so that's how I drifted into it through my mother's encouragement of something she felt I had an inclination toward. And I wrote poetry when I first began to write, you know. And she saw that and had them published in the papers, in the Amsterdam
News. All part of the same creative stream.
Mm-hmm.
How about you, Ossie? Why did you become an actor?
Well, I didn't intend to, and Ruby sometimes says I never did.
I never say that.
Did you say that?
I know. I never say that.
I remember one night, Ruby, on stage.
I love him.
On stage.
You said to him, I could...
And raising in the
I
sun
never said that.
In the middle of the scene, you're giving me notes. You don't remember that?
No, I don't.
Because I was awful. But wait a minute. To get back, why I became an actor, I wanted always and only to be a writer. But I wanted to write dramas. I don't know why this is so. So when I got to Howard University, I ran into Dr. Alain Leroy Locke, who was a distinguished scholar, first Black Rhodes Scholar and all of that. And he is the man who went around and found black talent and brought it to some fruition. Went all the way to Paris to find Langston Hughes. Right. Alain Leroy Locke did. So I was in his class. He invited me in, sat me down, said, "What do you want to do with yourself, young man? What do you want to make of your life?" So, "Well, I'd like to write, and I'd like to write drama." "Do you mean for stage plays?" I said, "Yes, sir." Now, he could tell from my accent that I had come from Bigfoot country. So he said, Ossie, where are you from?" I said, "Waycross." He said, "I mean, no, what's the name?" I said, "Waycross, sir." He said, "Well, have you ever been in the theater?" "Oh, yes, sir. See the cowboy?" He said, No. "Have you been in the theater where there were live actors up on stage?" I said, "No, sir." "And you want to write for the theater?" "Yes, sir." I said, "Well, you've given yourself a hell of a responsibility, but I'll tell you what you do. When you finish here, you go to New York, go to Harlem. There's a new little theater group called the Rose McClendon Players. Yeah. Find them, ask them to let you join, and if they let you join, hop in, do everything, build scenery, paint set, pass out lemonade, act, sing, dance, whatever. That way you'll understand what the theater is and whether you can write for it or not." Yeah. I was so impressed, I left college, came to New York, found that little theater, asked them to let me join, and I did that. Now, at that time, I was 6 feet two like I am now, but I only weighed about 115 pounds.
Oh, God, yes.
You know, with a deep bass voice and very southern. And that was the kind of
that was what they were looking for.
Yeah, I could get jobs, and writing is something that takes a long time. So all through my life, even up to now, it's easier to get a job as an actor than to sit down and do the grueling work of what a playwright must do.
You two are your life is a history in many ways of the associations and the experience that shaped America in terms of race.
We were close to it.
Let me ask you this. What are you proudest of in 50 years of or longer, but I mean in this life that you have lived, of which the majority of the time you've lived with us?
Yes. What am I proudest of?
Yeah. What's been the most meaningful for you?
The most meaningful. If the most meaningful thing, I suppose, has been this relationship with Ossie. I've learned, and we wrote each other a letter in the book. And
Will you read your letter to him?
No, because I haven't read it since I wrote it.
All right. You wrote each other a letter.
And so that's because I've learned.
Well, what did you say? You remember in your heart.
About myself. Well, we talked about love, you know, and sex, and beginnings of things, and scratching through to each other, and it's like coming out from deep, deep murky waters into the surface, you know, of life, where we could both see each other, and that's been meaningful. How does love flourish? Not only love man, woman, but how does love work? That has been, and when we talk about, and I've come to the conclusion that maybe that's why we're put here on Earth in the first place.
To make love work.
To make love work.
For individuals and for our partners and for the larger community.
For the larger community, that's right. That's what we're scratching through to. It's nothing to do with things, you know.
Let me close with Ossie. You basically say here, the last word here, you say, I think you're talking about kids and others. We want them to know that the essence of human history, the meaning of existence, did come to tarry a while in our home, in the bosom of one particular family, that the glory of God and the cumulative light of all knowledge is summing up of the entire human experience, civilization itself, shone at its brightest there. We want them to know that if only for one lifetime, under that one roof, all meaning came to rest. Time ran its endless circle through our living room, all space extended there, that our little band, happy for the most part, but crying together too, spent time at the center of creation, right next to the throbbing heart of God Himself.
I haven't heard that quote since
yes,
you wrote it.
It summarized what I think about ourselves as a family, and what a home means, and the gathering in of all information, all knowledge, the center of the universe. It should be right there. You don't have to reach out anywhere. It's right there within you. And if you quiet yourself and listen, you know, you'd be amazed at the things you can hear right in the bosom of your own family.
The heartbeat of life.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Great to see you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Ruth.
That's how
pleasure.
We know each other, I guess.
Thank you so much for coming. This book, Ossie Davis and Ruby D, with Ossie and Ruby, In This Life Together, December 15th. They will be honored with benefit for theaters here that are meaningful to them and meaningful to the larger community. I thank you very much for gracing my table.
Thank you for inviting us.
Thank you, Ossie. Thank you.
In this conversation, which took place in 1992, Ossie Davis and Ruby D reflect on the civil rights movement. They knew the principal players, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, and all of the others. They were friends of them, and they knew them, and they played a role in the civil rights struggle of America. In this conversation, Ossie and Ruby reflect on that remarkable part of their life, and they talk about their hopes for the future. You two have not only had this life that we've all seen on stage, separately and together, but you have been part of decade after decade of the civil rights struggle. Mm-hmm. You've been there, you've known all the players, many of them well, Martin, Malcolm. Was there a debate going on within the community? We know about Stokely Carmichael and Rap Brown and the Black Panthers who came a little bit later. Was there great debate during the 60s within the black community about nonviolence, about what's the right way to go, and some saying, yes, I hear Martin, others saying, no, I hear Malcolm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a great debate. And the truth of the matter is, it was a debate that was a part of the intellectual and political discussion that black folks have had since we got off the boat. Yeah. It really centers around the question, to what degree shall we consider ourselves Americans like all other Americans? Right. And to what degree shall we recognize that, whether we will it or not, there is racism and there is a difference? How do we react to that difference? Do we come to ourselves and collect our strength and reassert our own identity? Or do we make all efforts to say, in spite of who we are, we want so much to be inside that we're willing to give up some of the things that are very important to us? This debate has gone on. This debate still goes on in the country to this very day. Du Bois described it, I think, in 1905, you know, in his book.
William B. Du Bois.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Souls of Black Folks, when he said it's always a peculiar feeling, this doubleness, double consciousness that we have.
Two-ness.
You know, it's two-ness of the spirit. First, we want to be Americans, just like all the other Americans. Yeah. But we also want to be black without having to be ashamed of it or having to deny it as if it's a sin or a crime or something like that. That split has been the objective of black folks and black culture, is to sort of heal that split, to work out a philosophy that doesn't deny it but incorporates it, and, you know, sort of keeps us from shooting ourselves or shooting other people.
And where did, I mean, Martin said what? Dr. Martin Luther King was, you know, if you used a word like integrationist.
Yes.
That was the word they used at the time.
Yeah. Dr. King represented that part of black philosophy which says, like Frederick Douglass and others, we are Americans. Yeah. The Constitution, no matter what circumstances it was written under, applies to us. And we must press America to honor its own commitment to its own constitution on the theory that we two are human beings with all those rights granted in the Declaration of Independence. And we fight to do that. Now, Dr. King's brilliance lay in the fact that if you accept that theory, that our place is inside, and we're going to keep pressing till we get inside, then you must also guarantee to the people that you don't come as enemies, you don't come to blow the place up, you don't come to smash or even to get vengeance. You come merely on the basis that you too are human, you were born here, you fought for the country, and you have a right. And we believe that if people listen, they will think and they will hear. Dr. King counted heavily on that capacity of America, once it comes to a crossroad, to make the right decision.
Yeah.
You know. And there are others who say, no matter what you do, America is never going to accept black people. Never, never,
so
never.
So therefore the alternative, or therefore the imperative, is what?
Go within yourself, build your own self-esteem, build your own community, build your own economy, build your own politics. Establish for yourself a separate place and identity. Sometimes when it's extreme, somebody will say, give us 5 states. We don't even want to be bothering you. Yeah. Or go back to Africa.
Where did Malcolm come into this? You have seen this film.
Yes.
He was a friend of both of you.
Mm-hmm.
Where did he come?
I suppose the most remarkable thing about Malcolm is the evolutionary process. You know, I always think that it's a wonder we aren't all just stark raving mad, you know. I think America makes for a very schizophrenic address to life if you happen to be African American, because the messages are often very contradictory. And I think Malcolm mirrored that contradiction.
What's the contradiction?
With liberty and justice for all, you know.
Yeah.
And he found early that there was, early on, that was not so.
And his message was what?
I think ultimately his message was that we are all one people, that we are, that goodness and the divine spark within us has no color, that we really truly are sisters and brothers, I think.
That was the message at the end of his life.
At the end of his life, yeah. Yes. Yeah. But in the beginning, I think it was a separatist, yeah. Just as Garvey's was, you know, get out of the country, yeah. Just move out. And one was go to God, Martin Luther King, right. Go back to Africa, Garvey,
yeah.
Get some separate states, the Muslims, you know. We've been, this racism has kept us playing a terrible game, you know.
Arthur Ashe was here the other night, and he talked about an entire life, and he said there's not a day in his life that he doesn't face racism, and that is more a central fact of his life even than the fact that he has AIDS.
Yeah. I saw that. I was deeply moved by him on
I can believe
the conversation that the two of you had.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's true. However, there is a vast difference in the way that some of us are able to respond to the same set of circumstances. I think that in my case, and I think in Ruby's case too, we were the benefactors of certain cultural trends in the black community itself that sort of propped us up. A sense of humor, a religion that was meaningful, a black church that was independent, parents who understood and loved and cousined and protected us, but giving us that understanding that you may be small and you may be at the bottom and you may be surrounded and you may be weak and helpless, but if you can look at it and laugh, you know, you can live for another day, and maybe on the second day you'll get a better chance at it. I, luckily for me, you know, grew up in the household of a father and a mother who were great storytellers. Way across Georgia. And oftentimes, you know, when the cupboard was bare and nothing was on the table, we still could sit around and laugh because Daddy somehow had the capacity to explain the absence of food in terms that we could understand and enjoy.
And there was much love.
Much love.
And did they fuel the notion to be an actor, or did that come when you went to Howard?
No, my parents, you know, Waycross, we had no idea what an actor really was.
I didn't understand what television was.
I think my daddy would have been happy if I had been a doctor, and mama just was glad that I went to school.
Yeah.
But because my father was such a gifted storyteller, and because he told us the story of his life or his lives many times, I always felt that I wanted to write those stories down that my father had told me. And it seemed to me, I'm thinking now retrospectively, but it seems to me that my impulse in going to school was to learn to write and to learn where to put the commas so I could write those wonderful stories that Daddy had told me. So I was a writer long before I knew, you know, what it was I was about.
And now, a reader to us.
Yes, but I had no idea why I wanted to write plays.
Ossie Davis and I last saw each other at the Kennedy Center Arnold's in December. We spoke together with the admiring members of his family, including his wife. I will miss him. He was a great guest for this program because he stood for integrity and commitment and conviction. We honor him this evening for the life that he lived, and we grieve for the family that he left, who loved him so much, as did so many people. Ossie Davis, dead at age 87. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
Not all startup companies get started on Wall Street. Our local bottlers in South Africa have funded 3,500 small store owners, serving the people far from town, satisfying a thirst for a better future. The Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by J.P. Morgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
We are PBS,